Well, hello there, you malt. Quick glance to check my notes. Got to get this right. You malty malt hunters. And thank you to Emperor Prime for that malt mention. It's been on the list for a while, and thank you to all you malt mention contributors around the world. I do appreciate all your suggestions. If you seem to be waiting quite a while for your multi-mention to get malt mentioned, the reason is simple. I've got several hundred now. So I've got enough to last me for several years. So please be patient. And you won't have to be patient much longer to know which whisky review this is. This is whisky review 203. Fantastic. What exciting, precious, indispensable malt moment have I got for you? Well, we have concluded a run on Scotch independent distilleries, and with the previous three reviews, number 200, 201 and 202 being about Glenfarclas, I thought I'd take a wee break from the whiskies and address one of the questions that I get on a regular basis from all you malt mates out there. And that is, Ralphie, what advice do you give on hip flasks? Should I get one? What kind should I get? And how should I look after it? To be honest, I don't ever get asked about how do you look after your hip flask, although I have been getting asked about what do you recommend. So I'll cover quite a few little aspects concerning the hip flask, and why you should have one, what use it has, and all the rest of it. First of all, I'd introduce a simple 100 milliliter glass bottle and say that this can be used as a hip flask, because a hip flask is literally a whiskey receptacle, contain any spirit, but we'll say it's whiskey. A whiskey receptacle that can fit in your back pocket. Now, you do not put glass bottles in your back pocket, because when you're climbing up the hills or crossing some rocky ground, you're going to fall on your arse and you're going to smash it. And not only will you be lamenting the loss of your precious whiskey, which is now soaking through the seat of your backside and onto the rocks underneath, but you'll be wondering how long it's going to take you to pick the bits of broken glass out your bottom. So I do not recommend glass bottles as hip flasks because they're not really tough enough. You don't get that insurance policy of malt security that you get in a proper hip flask container. Now, if you go onto eBay, you will see plenty of hip flasks. And quite a number of them have got thistles on them and Highland cows and all the usual pish. Nice pish, but pish. And you think to yourself, well, you know, there's a nice kind of fancy ornate one. Should I buy that for someone as a gift? My answer is no. There is one traditional style of hip flask you should buy. And furthermore, you should also buy it in stainless steel, not pewter. Pewter is a combination of two other metals, lead and tin. Fingers crossed, I hope I can get my facts right with that one. And pewter is it's a relatively cheap, workable metal, and it was used back in 17th century Scotland, and tends to be cheap and useful for making memorabilia in the tit-tat shops, the touristy shops, and all the rest of it. I mean, just go to Edinburgh's Royal Mile, you'll see what I'm talking about. These flasks are not recommended because any whiskey, any spirit going into a pewter flask will become tainted sooner rather than later. Simple as that. Also, pewter flasks are weak. They're soft metal. They puncture very easily. I had it happen to me. Fortunately, it was a very small flask and I didn't lose too much whiskey. This is what I recommend. Here it is. Okie dokie. This you can buy cheap as chips on eBay, on the internet. It comes in a... There you go. It comes in a nice kind of what's called a kidney shape, and it's fairly narrow, and it comes in this false leather, or plastic leather, container. And very importantly, when you unscrew it, you'll notice, come on, don't pack up on me now, don't hang about, I know what it is. And it's undoing. Alright, okay, there we go, that's it. Splendid. I've just burst it. This is supposed to stay attached to the little hinge. And it means that when you unscrew it, you've got a proper, decent quality screw thread to hold it secure. You have got plenty of slack in the lid. And importantly, when you open it, you're not going to drop the lid into the heather, into the sand, into the grass and lose it. Very important that. When you fill the flask, I recommend you take a smaller flask and fill it to the top rather than a bigger flask and only half fill it. Because particularly if it's a single malt, you don't want it sloshing about too much. You don't want too much agitation. Or once you reach the top of your mountain or wherever you're going, you're not going to get the refined nose, etc. Not that you're particularly bothered, no doubt. I also recommend when you get back home, don't leave any whiskey lying about in the flask because it will deteriorate again. It just seems to be that is the way of flasks, hip flasks. I have myself kind of left a hip flask lying, and then I came back a few weeks later, poured a glass of Glenmorangie it was, and it just tasted flat as a pancake. So be warned, if you've got any left when you get back home after your big jaunt, pour it back into the bottle or drink it. If you are travelling with a friend, don't be selfish, be generous. Make sure you've got, it's exactly the same flask, but make sure you've got a flask for two. Because once you get to the top of a mountain or wherever you're going, you've got to celebrate that. Plenty of fresh air, no television, no news, no propaganda, no bollocks. You're having a day to yourselves out in the open. Fantastic. What better opportunity to celebrate with a wee dram? Because drams are not just about in pubs or with friends or on your own or in whiskey clubs. It's out and about on special occasions, making them that little bit more memorable. If you have to buy a gift for someone and you see these ornate stainless steel flasks like this one, again, it looks pretty sensible. I don't recommend them. See these fancy lids. Apart from the fact you can lose them, they actually weaken the bottle. They're not so good for carrying, so be warned. This is a great wee present. I bought this for £5. $6? In the German discount supermarket called Lidl, or Lidl, however you pronounce it. And this is just fantastic. If you're buying a gift for somebody and you don't want to stretch to the cost of a good bottle of whiskey, you can't go far wrong with this. However, a word of caution. Here we go. You will, sooner or later, come across these. This is what's called a hoop cup. Now the idea is that you kind of pull it out, right, it forms a seal, then you can fill it with your whiskey, and then you can enjoy a wee glass, and it's got an extra wide base so it doesn't topple over when it's lying in the heather. Now that's all good and dandy, but if you drop it, bash it, or don't pull it out properly, you will damage it and it will leak. So I don't particularly recommend that you take these unless you've got a pretty tough journey. A Glencairn, they're not that heavy. They're fairly durable. They'll do fine. It's either that you're going to have to swig out the bottle. Now, there you have it. Advice and hip flasks. There's plenty out there, plenty of variety, but go for the traditional shape. A genuine whiskey drinker will appreciate the traditional, practical hip flask rather than the fancy, ornate, unusable one. Also, when you've finished with your hip flask, a word of caution: don't just empty it and then screw the lid back on, because the residual alcohol inside, even with stainless steel, you will get a tainting which will affect the taste of what you next put into the flask. Rinse thoroughly shake with mild soapy detergent water, hot warm water and detergent in the kitchen sink, and then turn upside down and let it drip dry. Do not put the lid on while it's still damp. You let it air dry naturally before you refill it. If you leave any dampness inside, it will go fusty, and it's amazing how a little bit of fust, even if you can't smell it on your nose, will taint the next drop of whiskey that you put into your hip flask. Now, I'm going to conclude now by introducing you to a Monroe bagger. Now, I have been asked by Robert. Hello, Robert, out in New Zealand. You busy people out there. You've got plenty of open space, plenty of hills, plenty of mountains, and of course, you want to get to the top of them and celebrate. And what does Ralphie recommend? Ralphie recommends a Monroe bagger. A Monroe bagger is a peaty whiskey. Lafroy will do, of course. And Drambuie. Here it is. Drambuie is probably the most prominent of the Scotch whiskey liqueurs. Think of Vanderhoom, think of Benedictine, the oranginess in it. This is an orange rosehip liqueur. And it's pretty decent as well. And what you do is, also known in a cocktail form as an Aberdeen Angus or a Rusty Nail. Because you can replace, if you put it in with martini, it becomes a Rusty Nail. So you put in, 2/3 peaty single malt whiskey, and careful does it, got to get the proportions right. 1/3 Drambuie. I do seriously urge you to add a tiny drop of water, not much, and there you have a single powerful phenolic single malt sweetened with a competent Scotch whisky liqueur, which is quite citrus, and it gives you an intense peaty citrus moment. Now, you don't want any delicate whiskies in your hip flasks. You really don't, because if you're out and about and outdoors, you're really not going to get the finer nuances of these, you know, delicate malts, because they're getting blown away in the wind. What you want is something warming, something substantial, and something that delivers a big, hefty drop kick. And this is it. 2/3 Lafroy, 1/3 Drambuie. If you don't have Lafroy, you can use any peated whiskey you want. But Lafroy works best. So there you have it. It's not about subtlety. It's about heat. Delicious, reaching all the corners, heat. I conclude by saying that for all those of you a bit interested in Scottish culture, the Monroe is any peak in Scotland, because Scotland is a very mountainous country, any peak that is over 3,000 feet high. There are approximately, I'll refer to my notes for this, nice and subtle so nobody notices, 283 clean Monroes in Scotland, and there are others, peaks, sub-peaks, part of bigger mountains that are also over 3,000 feet. But clean or clear Monroes, there are 283. If you're on a peak in Scotland, in a hill or mountain, small mountain, and it's between 2,500 and 3,000 feet, it's called a Corbett. And if it's between 2,000 and 2,500 feet, it's called a Graham. There you go. Not many people know that. And you certainly won't find it in anywhere else except at Ralphie. Because Ralphie's eccentric, and a little bit bonkers. And frankly, I don't care. And there you have it. Ralphie.com. Whiskey reviews, whiskey stuff, whiskey marks, etc. And of course, a bit of whisky entertainment. Thanks for watching. I hope you found this interesting. Come back shortly for Whisky Review 204. See you soon.